Jurassic World Evolution is achingly close to release, and whilst it's a great game that I convinced a lot of you will fall in love with, despite its foibles, there's some stuff the game doesn't explain that well and that you'll want to know in order to create the best parks possible. A lot of this is more for when you want to aim towards those 5-star parks in the endgame, but there should be useful information here for absolutely everybody. So here we go folks, 10 things you should know before playing Jurassic World Evolution. When it comes to looking after your dinosaurs, their social need is critically important. A large number of dinosaurs need at least one member of their own species with them, and some need as many as 3 or 4. If you don't satiate this need quickly, their comfort levels will begin to drop and they will break out. Make sure you plan your exhibits around multiple dinosaurs, and be ready to incubate a replacement if one of your dinosaurs dies, and do it quickly, trust me on this one. Your dinosaurs also have an environmental need, how much grassland and forest they require. As of right now, this is handled a little bit weirdly. As far as I can tell, it's not based on the entire exhibit, but on a radius around your dinosaur. Try to keep your sauropods in particular, and other needy dinosaurs, in large exhibits and away from the fences, or you'll quickly find their comfort dropping because of the environment on the other side of the fence. It's not a great system, we hope it gets fixed, but for now you need to be aware of it. Another top tip, you can add the same upgrade to a building multiple times. This took me way longer to figure out than I would care to admit. If you don't care about how fast you can breed your dinosaurs, you can apply multiple quality upgrades to your incubators up to a total in the endgame of +90%. Now this is really the only way to guarantee top tier high quality dinosaurs, so it's something you're going to want to do. Similarly, upgrades on the Expedition, Fossil and Research Centres actually carry on to your other islands, so make sure you're upgrading them fully before you move on. Don't worry about the genetic system too much early on. It should be a low priority for research unless needed for a mission, and it's more important to just have some happy and varied, importantly, dinosaurs. In the late game, it can become very powerful, so feel free to catch up, but until you have good hatchery upgrades, it's difficult to really utilise it anyway. Other than skins, definitely always have fun with the skins. Halfway through, every single island in the game comes with pre-built buildings. It's a little disappointing at first, but in reality, not such a big deal. The default builds you're provided with are super inefficient, however, and space is definitely at a premium in this game, so I'd recommend saving up a little bit of money and leveling the buildings. You will get a partial refund, so just wait until you can afford it, level them, and place your own. Some islands such as Penna are maybe a little difficult to do this on the others it means you can squeeze out a lot more space for your parks. Plan for at least 3 to 4 to maybe even 5 power stations as well, especially early on in the game when you can only get the small ones and not the bigger upgrades. Dinosaur rating, however, in reality is pretty easy to obtain. Facility rating is where you're going to struggle and you need to be maxing out both to get a 5-star park. In order to boost that facility rating, make sure you've got plenty of hotels, you want at least 3 or so per island, use the management views to find problem areas in your park, and go into your individual buildings, restaurants and the like, and up the management numbers and the items you sell there to give the best rating. I found 3 buildings to be the most efficient and ended up relying on them entirely when aiming for nothing but rating in my parks. You know, you don't care about how it looks, you just want to max out your parks. You want to get the arcade, the restaurant and the clothes shop. These 3 together give your guests everything they could possibly need. Your monorails are also a large part of your facility rating and should be a high priority. You unlock them as early as Isla Muerta, the second island, and although they require a hefty initial investment of about 2 million I believe, they are absolutely necessary in the long term. You can use that aforementioned management view to find out where to place stations, and then you want to snake your monorail track around the park. If your transport rating is still low after doing this, and it will happen, what you want to do is look for long, unnecessary paths between areas. Force your guests to use your monorail and they'll increase your travel rating much more in response. Ladies and gentlemen, you can do all you like to keep your dinosaurs happy, but when storms hit on the later islands, your carnivores will start to drop in comfort regardless of what you do. This isn't a problem for a lot of them, they'll recover afterwards, but dinosaurs like the Indominus Rex will start to try and break out. Make sure you've got the top tier fences around these bigger carnivores and get ready to double up on fences if need be. If a fence does break, it's not always the quickest option to send your Jeep out there, you may want to just delete it and then manually replace it yourself. In fact, the Indominus Rex, however, is such a problem child, it might be worth double fencing no matter what the situation. Though be wary, it has a huge environmental need and such a double fence system is going to use up a lot of electricity. When you get sabotaged, and it is going to happen a few times no matter what you do really, there's a few different things that can happen to you. You can have power shortages, diseases, and gate openings. This of course means every single gate on all of your exhibits will open automatically and you'll have to manually drive over to close them. This isn't always a big deal early on, but later on when you're juggling many huge carnivores, it can lead to a fairly inevitable tragedy. You can, however, little tip, simply delete the gate before the carnivore gets to it. That gate will then be replaced by a piece of the fence it was placed on originally. Just remember to put it back in afterwards. Finally folks, just have fun with it. The game has some problems, we've talked about those already, and it isn't perfect. We're hoping it's going to get fixed a lot in post-release, but if you can take your time with this game, really enjoy watching your dinosaurs, enjoy making these dinosaurs, seeing all the beautiful different skins for so many different species, you will enjoy and even love this game. This is, I believe, the game we've been waiting for, and I really do advise people to just take their time, play through it slowly, and really immerse yourself into the atmosphere of the game. That'll help you sort of ignore the slightly strange little foibles and design decisions that have been made. Thank you so much for joining me for this video. We'll be back all of this coming week with two videos of gameplay, like playthrough every single day, and then a little bonus video on various different things, how to unlock different things, different achievements, blah 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 blah. Hope to see you there. Thank you so much for joining me as per usual. Cheers, much love as always. Bye bye. Quick little shout out at the end, this video and others like it would not be possible at all without the support of you guys watching me at home and also everyone on this Patreon page right here who supported me in the last month. If you want to help out as well, you can do so at patreon.com/bestinslot. Every little really helps. Cheers.